Floyd. All right, let's get an idea of who we got here. Where are all my business students, my sports marketing? Where are you guys? Raise your hand. Let me see. Yeah, there you go. All right, a lot of time we spent together last week. You guys did a great job. You're really going to enjoy seeing the final product today. Where are all my anatomy physiology people? All right, you guys are ready for this one? Got some really cool accents to look at. You guys going to really dive deep into that, think about the questions we talked about in class. And then finally, where are my intro to med students? Nice. We talk about foot and ankle, right? A couple questions about that. And then finally, my athletes, where are you? Yeah! All right, we're going to have an outstanding morning here. We have some real special guests. And I have to start by telling you, nothing would happen without some unbelievable support that we got from corporate sponsors. We have sports therapy here. Michelle, where are you? Are you here from sports therapy? And Jay's our trainer. They work at sports therapy. They were the first ones to jump on board and make sure that we make this happen. We also have Dr. Queller and the St. Charles group who jumped on board. And you know those guys, if you're athletes, they do our impact testing and concussion management through Jay, which is great. And then we also have Dr. Ritter's group and the advanced orthopedic group. And we have Dr. Merchant right here from them. And without those guys, they jumped on board and really made some significant donations so that we can make sure that we can get Kevin to William Floyd. All right, so when you started, you came in this morning, you saw a PowerPoint presentation that had pictures of two significant athletes have made a tremendous accomplishments. And the first couple words that were up there are very significant to the work that they do in the lives that they lead. Okay, it starts with courage and being able to go after big, big, audacious goals and make them happen through a lot of hard work and a lot of sweat. And obviously a lot of people that they'll be talking about are the people who are behind them and make that happen and support them all the way through, because it is not easy to get to the Olympic level on any stretch. It's a 4-year span in between games, and you have to be really dedicated. They talk a lot about adversity and perseverance. The two really go hand in hand. That will probably be the biggest message you walk out of here today with. That regardless of what you might be facing, if you worked really, really hard and stay with the problem and persevere, it will get better. It will get better. There will be people that will help you and support you. The two athletes we have here today could not get there without a lot of people helping them. And they'll be talking about that. In the end, our goal for all of us, whether you're an athlete or you're a student, is to be a champion regardless of your chosen field. If you walk out of here with the qualities that we start this presentation with, you will be a champion and you will represent Floyd significantly well. And that's our goal. That's what we hope for all of you. We believe that that can happen. Our first person I'm going to introduce is a world-class athlete, champion snowboarder. He's also a color commentator for the ESPN and covers a lot of the X Games. From the years 2007 to 2009, he exploded onto the snowboard world. And by the time 2009 came, which was the year before the Olympics, Kevin was the number one snowboarder in the world, beating Shaun White on a regular basis. Unfortunately, about 3 weeks before the 2010 Olympic Games in Vancouver, Kevin had an accident where he injured his brain. The movie that is out now on HBO and will be in theaters in November is called The Crash Reel. Kevin is the feature of that movie, but it includes a lot of messages that we can all learn from. So if you get a chance to see it in the theaters, I strongly suggest that you go to it, because it is about Kevin, but Kevin touches a lot of lives and has really influenced a lot of people over the last 3 years. It talks a lot about his family. It talks a lot about the relationships with his brothers. And there are a lot of things that you can walk away from when you see this movie. So I would like to start this morning off by a big round of applause and bring down Kevin Pearce.
Thank you. How are you, William Floyd? I thank you guys for having me. It's awesome to be here. I just got into Manhattan last night, and I'm from Vermont, so it's a little bit different for me to be in New York, and it's awesome. You guys have a really, really cool place. You get to grow up. To start things off, Mark was just talking about the crash reel that HBO made for about this story, and we made a little edit, so this will kind of give you a little idea of what it's been like for me for these last couple years and what this film's like.
Kevin Pearce, raised on maple syrup, sharp cheddar, weaned on the hills of Vermont.
This guy right here is slaying it.
What's cool is you have people saying that you're an Olympic hopeful and super excited to be going for it this winter. This whole French crew is this group of kids that we got, you know, rolling together, traveling and having a great time.
Danny, Mason, Jack, Luke,
Scotty.
Come on, Kevin! You're so rad! Yeah!
So Kevin started winning all the big air contests, slopestyle contests, halfpipe contests. He beat Sean. It was kind of like this miracle year for Kevin, and we were just kind of like, where did that come from? You know, because he was always like, you know, we were all neck and neck with him, and all of a sudden he kind of just flipped the switch and was like, all right, game on.
Going into the Olympics, Kevin was the guy to beat Sean White.
I think people are going to be blown away at what they get to see.
American snowboarder Kevin Pearce remains in critical condition tonight after a training accident in Utah.
It's okay. We're
gonna
move you now, okay?
We are on our way with him from no critical care to neuro acute care.
After how many days?
26 days. In intensive care. This is a big deal, boys.
No?
As he started to make any recovery, I mean, I'll never forget when I was sitting with him and I was holding his hand and he moved his finger in the palm of my hand.
How you doing?
You know, and then he would pinch with his right hand, but his left hand wouldn't work. So then we were like, you know, is he paralyzed? And then he'd get a blood clot in his arm, you know, so it was just constantly new hurdles to get over.
There's very little change, and then after that, it felt like there was like this amazing ladder of progression.
I dropped everything I was doing, I quit my job, and I was determined to be by his side for as long as it took for him to get better.
It felt really good because a lot of the times in the hospital, I'd see other patients without that support. I knew what worked for him and not necessarily all the therapists did, so it was easy for me to say, let's just turn this like to a little competitive game and he'll want to do it.
Yeah! You ain't got nothing!
All right, that's it, baby. 3 months in Craig and I'm out.
Later.
Here.
Made it!
I see problems down the line. I know that I'm mine.
Was a
easy squeeze.
Doing the same mistake twice.
Yeah.
Yo, check me out. I'm 7 months out right here and I'll be ripping around on this Segway. Mad fun.
Slow down, dude.
Snowboarding is my true love. And it's really hard to understand why I would ever want to get back on a board after what I've been through, unless if you really understood the feeling I had for snowboarding. It's just so exciting that I'm going to get back to it.
I still want to snowboard. I want that feeling back.
Medically, you cannot afford to.
Because of the way that the eye was injured, it's not realistic to expect single vision in every direction of the gaze.
What a day.
What's your name? Do you pick the song already? You're making me nervous.
It just feels like it's never ending. It's just like really never ending.
Wow.
You actually could die.
Get me out of here. Enough's enough.
If I feel 100% confident.
Nuh-uh. I just don't want to be done.
After I broke my back, I can't do a lot of the tricks I thought like that made it as fun for me. So snowboarding isn't as fun as it was.
My sense about you is you just want to do what you want to do. And you have a lot of confidence in yourself. But I think we're all talking about this because we love you so much.
I want to thank you guys for getting me back here and for making this possible. This is what we've been working on. Let's do this, boys! First contest back.
Race and ready, go!
Yeah, I was bummed out, and I wish I'd done well, but I definitely am not good enough and not in the place that I need to be.
The bad voice in my head says, it's not going to end. I'm never going to be able to get rid of this pain. I'm not getting past this brain injury. It's not going anywhere. 2.5 years later, hearing that your memory's at a 4%, I'm not even close. I really want to be happy and I want to be positive, and I feel like there's times that, you know, it comes across that I'm not, and I just really hate that. I just feel like whether it's the NFL, skiing, snowboarding, skateboarding, just like all these different sports, people are hitting their heads and they're having serious repercussions.
Okay, Trevor, touch your elbow. Where's your elbow? Can you touch it on your other side? Point to just your elbow.
Elbow?
Yeah, just your elbow.
This one?
Okay. So there are certain things that are a little off. For instance, the other days, Trevor, Alyssa, and Peyton, who's Trevor's 12-year-old brother, they all went golfing, and they got a golf cart because, of course, Trevor has a hard time walking. And all of a sudden, Peyton looks up and says, Trevor, are you trying to run me over? Snap. No control of impulses. And Trevor ran Peyton over on the golf course.
Directly over?
He knocked. So here's Peyton. Here's the golf course. Whipped him down and ran over. The entire golf cart was over. And the craziest was is that Trevor's facial expression was just like, yeah.
Just like, it was pretty funny. It was classic. Just running over your brother in a golf cart. Just like cruising right over him. I know you're brain injured. I know what it's like to be brain injured. I'm brain injured. It sucks. But you can fix it. You can change. You can work on it. And I know snowboarding's good, man. Snowboarding was awesome when we used to get to do it. But, you know, life's changed and things are different now. And you did not want to screw this thing up like we did. Because mine's screwed up too, man. But you gotta love it. You gotta realize that things have changed now. When I was a younger kid, I remember thinking that if something bad happens to me, I'm going to be able to come back, and I'm going to be able to come back really strong. And then it's like, it happened to me. It's weird to have thought that. And I feel like I've come back pretty good now. You know, I think the hardest thing for me to come to accept, and, you know, that I've been so fortunate because I have accepted, is how much my life has changed and just how different things are now and how different things will be forever.
Okay, now this looks good.
I'm getting thrown down.
Oh, watch this.
Fabio's here.
Fabio. All right, so that is a little idea of what the crash reel is like. It gets very in-depth about the story, and you know, I think that is a good teaser and kind of gives you a good sense of what it's been like for me these last 3.5 years. And you know, what has helped me so much through to get back and, you know, recover from this injury is these guys. Those are my three older brothers. That's David there down in the right, and then that's Adam there, and he has his hand over my shoulder. I think he'd be a little upset if he knew I was showing you guys that photo. And then my oldest brother, Andrew. And you can see there, Adam's kind of been there for me. Even from that age, he was like, kind of had my back. He had his hand over me. He was looking out for me. And then you guys saw it in there. He took a whole year off, quit work, and kind of, you know, took a whole year to be there to help me recover from this. And, you know, I was lucky because of my older brothers. I started riding from a really young age. And that was the first snowboard I ever got. Jake Burton, he actually has a house in Long Island. He owns Burton Snowboards. And he made that board for me. I wrote him a letter because they didn't make boards small enough for kids my age back then. And then, sure enough, that showed up in the mail. And that was pretty cool. And, you know, because my older brother snowboarded, I wanted to be like them and I wanted to snowboard. And so that happened. And I got into it at a pretty young age. You guys might recognize that kid. You guys probably all know Sean White, yeah? Yeah, that's Sean, and we have been, you know, riding together and friends for so long, and that's a photo of us together at the U.S. Open. I was 10 in that photo, and we were kind of riding together and giving each other a good battle for a long time now. That was 15 years ago, and then I kind of started coming up and getting better and got into it, and then I really started doing well. That's a photo of me at Trans World, and then right, that's PDN and obviously Sports Illustrated. And, you know, things really started going well for me. I went over to all these contests. I was traveling around the world. That's up in Norway up on the left. And then I was over at the European Open and over in Japan and winning all these events. And it was crazy. It was, you know, it was the most amazing thing ever. It was like I got to travel around, and that's what I wanted to do, was snowboard. And, you know, I started becoming successful at it. I'd show up in these countries and, you know, I'd win all this money. It was crazy. I think I showed up once in Japan and it was this big air event and in the stadium, and I ended up winning it, and I won like $20,000, and it was like the coolest thing. And I was, you know, I think I was 22 years old, and, you know, all my friends would go out and we got to go out and party, and, you know, it was pretty special. And then I'd come back and I was able to really kind of, you know, keep my head in the right place where I was able to do really well, but still continue to train and, you know, do the right things that have to be done in order to stay at that top level. And that happened for a while. And then it was 2009. And obviously you guys all know the Vancouver Winter Olympics were in 2010. And that was my goal, was to get to the Olympics, and I wanted to beat Sean. Sean was the kid that was doing so well, and he was the one that, you know, I needed to beat. And in order to beat him, I needed to learn these new tricks. But the new tricks were difficult and very dangerous. So in order to do that, Nike built me this half pipe in Mammoth, California. And I had this idea that if we chopped the bottom off the half pipe and put an airbag on it, we'd be able to try these tricks and land on our heads, land however, and it was safe, and you just fall in the airbag and you'd be all good. So I did this, and I tried these tricks over and over and over again into this airbag, and then I had a couple of my friends up there with me and finally got to the point where they're like, okay, you're good. You could try this on the half pipe. So there's one called a double McTwist, and it's where you're going forward, and you dip your left shoulder down and you dip it twice, and then the goal is to land it and ride away. And that was the first one I ever did, and it was like really cool. You know, I'd been working so hard and I put so much time and energy into learning that trick, and then it was like, okay, I got that one. That's important, but I need more. Like, Sean's really good now and I want to beat him, and in order to beat him I need to, you know, learn all these tricks. So then it was like, all right, I want to try to learn a trick called a cab double cork. And so I don't know how familiar you guys are with snowboarding, but cab is when you're going backwards. So it's when my right foot's forward and you go down and you drop in and you kind of come up backwards and kind of flip it backwards twice while spinning. And I tried the cab double cork into that airbag many, many times. And then finally, after watching all the footage, my brother and my friends were like, all right, you can take it up onto the wall. You're good now. And I wasn't good. I wasn't quite ready to be able to try that one. And, you know, it was difficult. I remember it was like my ankle. I was lying down there in the bottom, and then that's Adam right at my feet. And I was like, dude, my ankle hurts so bad. But I, like, Nike built me this half pipe and I wanted to ride, but it just hurt too bad. So they took me down and I went to the hospital and got x-rays. And the doctor's like, no, you're all right. It's just a really bad sprain. You know, it's a really severe sprain. Just stay off it for a little while. You can't go up and ride the half pipe anymore, but you'll be good. So I took a couple months, and then finally I went back to another hospital in Portland, Oregon, and found out that my ankle was broken. And that was, you know, that was really, really difficult to come to grips with. It's like, okay, it's the summer of 2009. My ankle's broken, and the Winter Olympics are coming up. Luckily, I was able to heal. I was able to get it going good enough that I started riding again the beginning of that winter. And then I was like, all right, the Olympic qualifiers are coming up. I need that cab double cork. And as you guys just saw in that edit, that cab double cork just wasn't the trick for me. And that was crazy to, you know, to have that, and I don't remember any of that accident. And it's kind of interesting because I've talked to a lot of folks about this, and, you know, some people say they don't think it looks that bad. I'm like, that crash I just showed you before that one, I thought it looked a lot worse. And, you know, like, that one obviously ended up.
American snowboarder Kevin Pearce remains in critical but stable condition tonight after a training accident yesterday.
He was wearing a helmet at the time, but still sustained some serious injuries.
That one obviously ended up being a lot worse, and, you know, the following months were, you know, a lot worse than just a broken ankle. And for me, I put up there the easy part because this was the easy part. There was those 27 days that I was in the critical care. I have no memory of, you know, I have no memory of that fall or that day or the next month that, you know, followed up from that. And it's just crazy to see these pictures and to see that footage and to see what I went through and, you know, what I put my family through. And, you know, it's just so amazing that I had them there with me to help me through all this. And then this, you know, was a big one for me. It was the wake-up call. It was like, that's in the hospital there. And it was like waking up and realizing, it's like, okay, I am now brain injured. And, you know, this is something that I need to come to terms with and I need to come to accept. And it took me a long time to, you know, accept the fact that I was brain injured and that, you know, my life is changed forever. And, you know, that things are much different now. And this is a photo. I was in the rehab hospital and one of the therapists comes up to me and she goes, oh, Kevin, this is about a month and a half after the accident. The therapist goes, okay, Kevin, draw a person. And at that point, a month and a half later, that's what a person looked like to me. I'm not too sure if you guys can make a person out there. I can't really. But that is what I was thinking a person looked like. And so it was like, okay, coming to grips with the fact that I have a long way to go and a lot of healing to do. And then the doctors, you know, I got a lot of support and a lot of help from doctors. And the doctor was like, you need to wait 2 years till you get back on a snowboard because your brain needs to heal. And when you injure your brain, it's like it takes so long. Your brain doesn't like to give you that information, like say your wrist or your leg or your foot does, that when it's broken, you know it's broken. Like when your head's broken, it's so much harder to know and to understand that it's broken. And so I waited 2 years from, you know, doctor's advice to get back onto the snowboard. And then that was, you know, the first day back on the board, I got to go out to Vail, Colorado with a bunch of my friends, and my mom came out, and that was that was a special day for me to get back on it. And, you know, I think for sure the biggest part for me through this has been my family. That on the left is the whole family. And then that on the right is a photo of me and Dave, my one of my brothers. And Dave's been a huge part of this. As you can see from that photo, he has Down syndrome. And in the film, we talk about how we all call it up syndrome, because he's an up kind of kid. And he's been such a huge, huge piece of this recovery for me, just because things for these guys with Down syndrome is much harder and it's much slower. And, you know, it takes much longer for David to do everything. And, you know, that's kind of how it's, you know, now that's what it's like for me now. It's like life is much harder and, you know, I have to do things much slower and it's much more difficult. But with the help and love and support of my family and then Dave being there by my side, it's been, you know, pretty incredible what I feel like I've been able to do to come back from this. And then obviously you guys just saw it, this film got made, and I would highly recommend if any of you guys have HBO to try and check it out. It's on HBO Go, and it's really cool to see what they've been able to do for me. And now I can't snowboard like I used to, and that's hard because I was doing so well and I was so successful at it. And it's like now my brain is so injured and that I can't put myself at that kind of risk. But I am back snowboarding, and here's a little video of the kind of stuff I'm doing now, and it's still really fun, and I'm able to have a good time at it. As you guys can tell, that's a little different than doing double corks in the half pipe, and it's really fun, don't get me wrong, but it doesn't that's not taking up all my time, and you know, that's not like what I'm working so hard on now. So it's like I got to figure out what I'm gonna do, and you know, it's been a huge shift in my life to kind of change over to, you know, figure out what's new, and that's been really hard for me. And what I have done and what I've found that I, you know, I can get a lot out of and I can really gain a lot is from starting this this fund. It's called the Kevin Pearce Love Your Brain Fund. And you can see I have a t-shirt on now and it says love and the O is a brain. And the idea is to love your brain, because after you injure it, you need to love it to bring it back and, you know, to heal it. And in order to do that, a piece of that is we're selling these t-shirts on my website. And my dad is selling these bowls. He makes hand-blown glass, and he's selling these candle holders. And all the money we're getting, I think it was over $500,000 for me in that hospital. The first day I was in critical care in the University of Utah, and it was $30,000 a day to be in that hospital. Luckily, I was fortunate enough to have insurance that took care of that. But there's so many kids out there that are getting injured playing these sports, and they don't have that help, and you know, they're not fortunate enough. So that's been really cool to be able to spread this love and share this, you know, with these kids that need the help. And you know, if there are any takeaways from this that I've learned, it's, you know, one, you need to go out there, and I saw that most of you guys are athletes and most of you guys play sports in here, and you need to go out there and have fun. And, you know, that's why I love snowboarding so much. It was, you know, the athletic part. I'm very dyslexic and I hate school, and, you know, it was really hard for me. But being able to get out there on the field and get out there in the mountains, it's like that's what lit me up, and, you know, that's what I love the most. But school is very important. So I did graduate high school, but I didn't make it to college. And that was a huge one for me, is, you know, to be able to get this going and, you know, to be able to have this sport that's so amazing. And, you know, the second biggest one is that if you do injure your brain, is to make sure you guys give it enough time to heal. And, you know, it, like I was saying, your brain doesn't want to tell you, and you're going to think that you're fine and, you know, that you're all good to get back and whatever it is. If you're playing football, if you're playing soccer, it's like if you do hurt your brain, you need to give it the time. You saw that kid Trevor in the video who had two traumatic brain injuries, and, I mean, he's running over his brother in a golf cart. That's how bad he is now after getting his second traumatic brain injury. So that's the biggest one for me to share with you guys, is to make sure you give it the time and, you know, go out there and have fun and play these sports, because that's what I'm all about. But also work hard, because I can tell this is amazing school, and that's very important too. So have both. You know, you got to have the balance, school and play and sports. So thank you guys so much. Oh, yeah, we'll do some questions after.
Once again, thanks, Kevin. And what we'll do is at the end, we're going to have both athletes up here at the table taking questions, so you'll get a chance to actually interact with them. And if, I know you probably guys probably have some questions on your minds that you want to ask. But the next part is really to kind of put the story together for you on how William Floyd was so lucky to get Kevin to come here. And it started with a student athlete of ours who was a gymnast who suffered a concussion last year, really struggled in her road recovery to come back, but did work very hard, followed the orders of the doctors, followed the orders of Jay to the T, and was fortunate enough to be able to come back to gymnastics this year. But over the summer saw a movie on HBO called The Crash Reel, came running into my office and said, "Oh my God, do you know Kevin Pearce?" And I said, "Yeah, I kind of know who he is." And he says, "Well, I just saw this movie and I didn't know it was on HBO yet. I thought it was coming out in theaters." So I was like, "Oh, I didn't know it was on." He's like, "Well, I emailed a couple times trying to get him here. Do you think that Joey would know him and somehow we could try to get a hold of him?" And that was a great idea. So the person who really started it all was Christina Prokhoff, if you could stand up. So that brings us to our next athlete and how it all came together, because there is a connection between the snowboard world and Long Island, believe it or not. And that connection for William Floyd was a guy that grew up in Mastic Beach. I'm lucky enough for him to be my son, so I close my eyes now when he does stuff that Kevin does. It's unbelievable. But he, like Kevin, has been working extremely hard. He used to leave William Floyd in the wintertime to go to Vermont, leave his friends behind, travel all over competing and working out at the Stratton Mountain School. He went to the same school as Danny Davis and the Matroni brothers. He followed Kevin, and, you know, Joe's group really looked up to those guys. They were the pioneers of the sport. And Joe has really put himself in a position where this is going to be a big year. To give you an idea, in his junior year at Floyd, he won USASA National Halfpipe Championship, which qualified him for the Olympic trials in 2010, which were the same ones that Kevin went through. And Joe ended up finishing 23rd in that, which was pretty good as a junior in high school. But then that forced him or put him in a position where he had to choose between coming back to Floyd full-time or staying in Vermont, because he had to be serious about one sport or the other. And he was going to be the quarterback here at Floyd. So it was a tough decision. I believe he made the right one and followed his heart and his dreams and followed and stayed with snowboarding. He's continued to rise up through the ranks. He's won the Gatorade Free Flow Tour. He's a two-time U.S. Revolution Tour champion. He's been in the Grand Prix, the World Cups. He represents the United States on the U.S. snowboard team at several World Cups in Europe as well as Canada. and he is qualified for the Olympic trials this winter. So we have a real legit shot of having the first William Floyd athlete ever to be in an Olympic Games. He's going to tell you about what he's doing now to get ready for that dream to come true and his relationship with Kevin. So I give you Joe Mensch.
How are you guys doing? Yeah. Well, I'm not the best public speaker, and I can't. I have some things to read off of, so bear with me, please. So I first wanted to say how excited I am that we were able to bring such a legend of snowboarding to William Floyd High School. I've always looked up to Kevin growing up. He had a very unique style, was always trying something different than everyone else was. Growing up watching snowboarding movies, I really appreciated his true passion for snowboarding. Between his hard work and determination to become one of the best snowboarders in the world, which he is, and then find himself fighting for his life and the ability to walk again was truly inspirational. Kevin was not only shown the love he has for the sport of snowboarding, but more importantly, his love and passion for life. Life and family. And now I'd like to share with you a video from the past season where Kevin had a great influence on my riding and my recovery from injury I suffered at the U.S. Open last year. After the video, I'd like to talk about how Kevin influenced me off the snow to prepare for the upcoming Olympic trials in December.
Thank you.
So after suffering that injury, which I got very lucky and only had minor injuries from that fall, it took me out of the rest of the season. I still had a few more World Cups to go to, and it was really hard for me to, you know, put aside that I wasn't able to go to them, and I really needed to get physical therapy and train and work on that off snow and, you know, take that time to recover. But that really helped me a lot, and I started seeing a sports psychologist to kind of help me regain that confidence, and he showed me how I can get back and different techniques I was able to use to get back, like breathing techniques, visualization, and see myself being able to go back out and, you know, try those tricks again that I was falling on. You know, it was really hard to get back on snow and to try the trick again that I got destroyed on. But it was kind of cool just to see how like the visualization and everything was helping me get through it and knew that I was able to do it still. And the biggest thing I wanted you guys to know is, like, going through this is having a great support group, whether it's your friends, your teachers, your families. You know, you gotta surround yourself with good people that believe in you and are gonna push you. So, you know, you might not like the way you're being pushed or anything like that, but they know what's good for you and that's gonna help you succeed. So I remember my first time coming back on snow, I got invited to a progression camp with Bud Keene, and I'm sure Kevin knows that. He's like a drill sergeant, you know. He knows what's best for you. It's his way or the highway. And so I was kind of nervous coming into that just because, you know, I wasn't really sure if my knee was ready, if I was, like, you know, going from not riding for 4 months to going into a progression camp, which with Bud Keene, I was like, he's going to make me do a double. I knew that not leaving there without doing a double was going to be a problem. So it was really hard for me because I haven't ridden in so long, my confidence wasn't there, and I was just really, really nervous. And you know, I called my mom and dad, my girlfriend, I'm like, I don't know if I'm ready for this, I don't know if I can do it. And they're like, you just gotta relax, you're there for a reason. He wouldn't have asked you to come if he didn't think that you were able to do this. And, you know, this is a make or break thing. And if you wanna be able to, you know, continue, this is a trick that you really needed to do. And after Kevin got hurt, it's just every time I thought about the trick, and it was just really hard for me to grasp the concept of, like, I was able to try it and I was able to do it. But everything was set for me there. I had the airbag there, and he gave me the green light. Everything was safe, so I went for it. And, you know, his support and pushing me to be able to do it and making me believe that I was able to do it was such a good thing. So, you know, surrounding yourself with great people, whether it's family, teachers, you know, they need to be able to push you and just make sure that in your head that you know you can succeed and get to a greater level. With that, you know, you gotta set goals for yourself, and, you know, little things like little challenges, and everything's never gonna be perfect or follow the yellow brick road. It's nothing like that. So set little goals for yourself, whether I'm surfing or I'm snowboarding, taking pictures, you know, working out. I try and set, like, little goals for myself and just little things to accomplish that gets me to that larger goal. And it's just the little things that you got to worry about. So, and I just want to leave you with one thing that I came up with. The difference between a champion and not is being able to accept the challenges that life throws at you, whether it's school, job, sports, or family, and succeeding when all the odds are against you. So just believe in yourselves and try your best, and you'll be able to accept those challenges one day.
Another round for these two athletes. Go. All right, so what we're going to do now is we're going to open it up for some of our students. They have come up to me and said, I got a question. Shut up, Christina. I got a question. Jesus, every day. So we're going to start to move it around a little bit and give you an opportunity to interact with these athletes. So we are going to start off with the woman who started it all. Here's your shot, Christina. I'm coming. Ready? Christina.
How did you deal with the brain injury? Like, was it rough? I mean, obviously it was rough. Like, how long did it take?
That's been the hardest part about this, is kind of coming to grips and really learning what was wrong with me. And, now I've realized that a brain injury is a lifelong, injury, and it's something I will always be healing from, and I will always be working on getting better. And, there are always things that, come up that I have to deal with, and things that I, ways that I can continue to get better. So, it's been crazy. I never would have imagined, obviously, that there's an injury that, can be there. And it's hard, might be hard to tell because it's not a physical injury, but, my brain is going to continue to heal. And if I work at it, I will keep getting better.
Okay, so what I'll do now is, since I want to make sure we get a couple people in the back, a couple of teachers in the back, if there's someone that wants a question, grab them and bring them down so we get them on the mic, and I'll start working around here. Eddie, I think you had one, didn't you? A question? A question? Anybody in front? Oh, we got one right here. Very interesting story. Stand up. This is Andrew Albin. This guy, I want you guys to know, it's almost like he's my son now. It's been 2 years, right? Yes. He unfortunately blew the ACL in one knee. We did through 9 months of rehab. I got him back thanks to Jay, our trainer, doing all the work, and we were working out together after school. He would come at 5:30 in the morning, work out before school. We let him go. He goes back on the field, blows out the other ACL. And now he has been dealing a lot, like what Joe said, about the confidence issues and things. But when he found out you guys were coming, he said he wanted to ask a couple questions, so I'll turn it over to you.
At what point did you realize, for you, Kevin, that you realized that you had a brain injury and you had to deal with it? At what point in time?
Well, I realized very quickly I had a brain injury. It was like as soon as I was, out of my coma and, awake and there, I understood that I had a very severe brain injury. But it wasn't for about 2 years till I realize how much my life was going to be changed and, how differently I, needed to do things now. And it took me a long time to come to the understanding in my brain to realize the fact, of how much I needed to switch my lifestyle. So it took a while.
Besides snowboarding, what were some ways that you had to gain your confidence back?
I've tried, doing a lot of different things, and one, public speaking, getting up in front of a lot of people is, it's not always that easy, and it definitely is a little bit scary, but that one, has really helped me gain a lot of confidence. And I'm a very active kid. As I was saying, I have the learning disability, dyslexia, so school was always tough for me. So getting out and being active and living that lifestyle has been very, very important.
All right, thank you.
All right, coming over, John, let me see, Anthony Romeo.
I didn't really have a planned question, but thank you. Sorry. With sports psychology, for Kevin, when you went through that, what was one thing that really helped you get through your tough time?
What was most important for me and, what helped the most was, my family and, everything they were able to help me with, how much support they were able to give me. And, You know, it was, you know, it was hard. It's really, really hard when you're that dedicated and you put that much work into something and then you find out that you lose it and it's just totally, you know, taken away and it's like just not gonna happen anymore. So it took a long time to, you know, come to grips with that, and I still, you know, fight daily with the fact, you know, I watch my buddies up there and they drop in for the X Games and it's like that's all I wanna be doing. So, you know, it still is definitely a struggle, but you know, I'm definitely, you know, getting to the point where I'm getting better at dealing with it, but it's still hard.
One more thing. Was there ever, I mean, I'm sure there was, but was there a time where you looked at your situation and said it could have been worse?
Yeah, you know, I do that every day. You know, I look at this and I look at how lucky I am, you know, to be able to be here and walking and talking and in this kind of shape. You know, it's so incredible that, you know, I've been able to make this kind of recovery from such a traumatic injury. And, you know, I'm just so happy and I'm so lucky that it's turned out the way it has for how bad it was.
Thank you.
I got a question for Joey.
Yep.
Knowing about his brain injury, like, what gave you the motivation to get on the snowboard and do all those tricks?
To get back into it?
Yeah.
Just my pure love for the sport. You know, I love to be able to compete and try new things and try things differently than, you know, most people. And, you know, I couldn't wait to get back. And as much as I dreaded trying that trick again, it's just, you know, that was like one of the goals that I had, was to be able to get back and, you know, do that trick again. So to be able to, I want to be able to get to the point where I was before and then, you know, see myself excel past that. And that just my sheer passion for it, and I love it so much. And this is, you know, just being, you know, being away from it for that long, it's just, it's hard, you know, you just want to get back out there. And I think that's what drove me just to get back to it.
For you, is there anything you regret?
You know, looking back at it, I wouldn't say I have any regrets, just because, like Joey was saying, you know, it gives, snowboarding is so special to us, obviously, and it gives us this special feeling, and I had so much fun doing it, and it was so amazing for me to be so successful at it and to do so well at it, and it was like such an amazing time in my life that, you know, I would not, you know, change anything that I did.
This is a question for Kevin. At one point, you were the best at something in the world. How did that feel?
That was cool. It's a good feeling to be really, really good at something. And, you know, it's hard. It's really hard to go from being that good at something to being that bad at something. And it's like, you know, I think to, you know, your average normal snowboarder, they'd say I'm not bad, but compared to where I was, and, you know, you saw that video of Joey where he is, it's like I am pretty bad now, and that's a really hard thing to come to terms and to deal with, is from being so good to being so bad. So that's been a struggle for me to, you know, kind of come to terms with that and understand it. But, you know, at the same time, it's like, it's been a real learning process, and it's like I got to fight to get back, and it's like I got to fight to get better, and, you know, to keep working hard, and, you know, that's important, you know, whatever it is. Whatever you're dealing with it, whether it's a sport or, you know, whatever you're faced with, just to know that you can come back and you can recover.
Thank you. Kevin, you think you look bad? I got a video of me snowboarding. You're going to feel great. You watch me snowboarding. All right? All right. Next question over here.
Kevin, I have a question for you. Did it ever, like, occur to you that you might be able to, like, competitive snowboard again? Like, did it affect you day by day?
Yeah, you know, there was a long time there that I held on to it. I held on to that fact that I was going to be able to get back there. And, you know, I talked about it in the crash reel about how I was in that hospital, and I can remember very definitely thinking that I was going to be able to get to the Olympics and that I needed to get out of that hospital bed so I could go and train for the Olympics. And, you know, sure enough, I didn't get to snowboard for another 2 years. You know, that's how injured my brain was. I thought I was going to be in the Olympics, and I couldn't even snowboard for another 2 years. So, you know, it was, you know, very, very hard process to deal with that, and, you know, to get, you know, figure out how to get my brain around that, and, you know, how to, you know, be okay with the fact that I'm alive and I'm healthy and, you know, I'm doing well. And it's like, that's, you know, they're more important things I've learned than, you know, getting back and getting to the Olympics.
Was it harder for you to, like, get back?
Yeah, you know, getting back to snowboarding is hard, and I talked about it in that contest that I did, that I'm so much worse now, and it's like, it's so much harder for me now that it's hard, because I feel like I should be able to go up and do those double corks and do all those things that I could do before, but, you know, I just can't do it anymore. So to have that feeling, it's interesting to be able to feel that way, but then not be able to do it. It's really weird.
Do you ever think you're going to be as good again? Like, does it frustrate you that the accident happened and then, like, you try harder and harder each time?
Yeah, you know, it is frustrating. I do believe that I won't get back to that level, but I do know that I have room to progress, and I will keep getting better. I'm not going to get that good again, because I like to think I was pretty good back then, and I don't think I'm going to get back to that point. But, you know, I do know there's a lot of room for progress, and, you know, it's hard work, and, you know, that again, it relates to all you guys. With hard work, you can get better, and you can, you know, continue to progress. So that's been cool for me.
Well, good luck with that.
Thank you.
I just want to say thank you for an inspirational story. I probably speak for all the athletes in here when I say that. And my question is, after injury, understanding and coping with you were different. How did you cope with that, especially as an athlete at your caliber?
You know, that's been, again, you know, this injury has been really hard, and coping, you know, coming to grips with that and understanding, you know, how different I am now and, you know, how different my life is now has been really hard. And, you know, it's interesting. And David, my brother who has Down syndrome, has been a huge piece of helping me deal with that, because he, you know, having Down syndrome, he's very different, but he is also a very special kid, and he's so amazing. And, you know, that's helped me kind of, you know, understand that I can, you know, be different now, and I can, you know, be, you know, much at a much different level in snowboarding, but I can continue to be happy. And, you know, you need to take these changes that are thrown at you in life, and, you know, just try to accept them and, you know, take them and, you know, make the most out of them. You know, just doing this foundation, you know, the Kevin Pearce Fund, it's like, I'm different now, but I can help people. And before, I was helping myself with my snowboarding, and it was all about me. And now I can, you know, lend support and, you know, help other people that don't have that. So I'm trying to make the most out of it and take a positive from a, you know, a really bad negative.
Thank you.
This is for Kevin. I was just wondering, obviously from the picture that you showed us, you did have like a bond with Sean White, and I was just wondering, how has that like changed over the years, especially after the accident?
Ooh, the Sean White question. Ooh, I knew it was going to come. Me and Sean have grown up. Like I was saying, we've always grown up friends, and, you know, it's interesting because he is, you know, really cool, and I do really like him, but he's so big now and he's so famous now that he has so much other stuff going on. And, you know, to be completely honest with you, I don't get to hang out with him that much anymore. I don't really see him that much, but when I do, he's really cool to me and he's really nice, but we just don't get to spend that much time together.
And my other question is for both of you. If you guys could snowboard with anybody, it doesn't have to be a professional snowboarder, dead or alive, who would it be?
Ooh.
Dead or alive.
Snowboarding's still pretty young. There aren't that many dead snowboarders.
It's still pretty young. I guess I would have to say Terrier, just because, you know, he started everything for us. He was such an inspiration. He was doing everything different than everyone else. He didn't care about contests. He didn't care about, you know, points or anything like that. He just wanted to snowboard, and he just did his own thing. And
you know, he's been such an inspiration to, I'm sure, Kevin and myself. So I think that's who I would want to.
Yeah, you know, I'm so lucky, and I just feel so blessed. I've had the ability to be able to snowboard with all these guys, and pretty much most of the guys in snowboarding now I've snowboarded with. And I think, you know, to turn that question around, I would say my favorite guy, because I've gotten to snowboard with everybody that I could ever dream of snowboarding with, is a guy named Nicholas Mueller. And he's the one that does the powder, and he does that backcountry, like that video I showed you. And he just kind of has really helped me and really taught me so much about how to be the best I can at that.
Thank you.
Kevin, if you could go back to the day that you got your brain injury, would you change what happened to you?
Wow, change it. I would. You know, I definitely would. You know, I would try to go back, and, you know, I would have tried to do that trick a little bit different. Instead of landing like that in the half pipe, if I had landed like that, I think I would have been okay. So, like, if I had gone a little faster and a little bigger, maybe I wouldn't have caught my front edge. And, you know, that was, you know, just so big, you know, that it was just like that tiny, such a small little error. But you know what I don't think I really said in the speech is, you know, the importance of helmets. And I had a helmet on that day, and the doctors are, you know, very, very sure that if I didn't have a helmet on, I would not have lived. And it's like, it's so easy, you know, in a sport like snowboarding, to just throw a helmet on. And it's like, these sports are so dangerous now, and it's so much fun that, you know, is a huge one for me. And my mom and dad told me, they knew obviously how dangerous it was, and they were like, boys, if you guys don't have a helmet on and you get hurt, we're not coming to the hospital. And so I was lucky I had a helmet on that day, because I really needed them in the hospital.
All right, thank you.
I have two questions. If you were able to do that trick again, even if it was into an airbag, would you?
Nope. All right. No, I don't like that trick. You saw what it did to me twice.
And at one point with both of you, during your injuries, did you just want to quit after the injuries? Did you just want to quit, or was there something there that just wanted you to keep going?
You know, for me, I never got to that point where I wanted to quit. And I always kind of saw room for improvement, and I still do see room to heal and room to get better. And I know it's a fight, and it's a daily struggle. And, you know, every day I have to work on getting better, but, you know, that's kind of who I am. And, you know, that has, you know, led to such a better, you know, more happy, exciting, successful life for me. So, yeah, I've never been a quitter, and I think that's a huge one, is, to work hard and to put everything into it.
Definitely didn't ever think about quitting. With snowboarding, it's like, if you don't get hurt, you're not really progressing, you're not really trying anything, you're kind of staying in the same spot. So it goes along with the sport. So for me, it was just, you know, putting in the dedication and the hard work to be able to get back out there, and, you know, setting a goal to be able to get back out there. And, you know, we set a first date to get back to the World Cup. That didn't happen, so that was obviously frustrating. And then it was the end of the season, so now I was like, well, I have nothing to do, but, you know, just had to keep focused and keep trying to get back as fast as I can. But no, I never would give up, and I don't think I ever could give up.
So, thank you.
Yeah. Both of you guys are such, like, inspirations for athletes. So, like, after your brain, like, your incident, like, that turning point in your life, even though, like, now you physically you can't do, like, the same thing you did before, like, do you feel mentally stronger than you did before that incident?
I don't know, mentally strong.
Well, like,
I feel like I've learned a lot, you know, yeah, and I feel like it's definitely opened my eyes, you know, in a much broader way. And before, it was like all snowboarding for me, and that's where my head was. It was like, I'm a snowboarder, and that's what I do. And now it's kind of opened up a lot more, and I feel like much more bigger, important opportunities.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Well, my friend
Molly stole my question. But if you could go back and not even just change what you did that day, this is actually for both of you, would you make the decision to say, like, I'm not ready to do that trick, so, like, I'm not going to do it today?
No, it was, I've been waiting, like, 2 years to try that trick, and I kept saying, no, I'm not ready, no, I'm not ready, no, I'm not ready, but there comes a point where, you know, you keep saying to yourself you're not ready, but, you know, you really are, and, you know, it's just, the first time ever doing something like that or a different trick or trying something new, it's just, it's terrifying. But like once I tried the double and it really wasn't that scary. Once I came around and like knew where I was, like air awareness and like, wow, that really wasn't that bad. So, you know, no, I wouldn't change that for sure. Just have to do it.
Yeah, you know, I'm much different in the sense that I did feel ready, and I did feel like after trying it into the airbag that many times that I was ready to do it into the actual half pipe, and I, you know, I wanted to do it, and that's where I was like, I knew I needed to do it in order to be good enough to make the Olympic team, and so I was, like, so excited to get to go out there and do it, and so it was just kind of crazy to, like, to be so confident and so ready and then have that happen to you. It was pretty wild.
Thank you.
Before I ask my question, I just want to apologize to Ms. O for asking this, but I'm sorry. But I need to ask this for a lot of the cross-country girls. How nice would you say Sean White's hair is? I need to know. I need to know.
His new hair or his old hair?
When it was nice and long and luscious and...
Not that nice.
No? Oh, man.
How much did you... Why? Did you love his hair?
I did.
All right, we did. We just became worst enemies.
I'm sorry. I hate his hair now, though.
His hair's gorgeous. It is. He has the most beautiful long blonde red hair.
I know. And like in that movie with Friends with Benefits, when he just like whipped around, I was like, oh! It was great. It was so great. And my other question is for Joe. How does it feel to be back at Floyd, and do you still consider yourself a colonial?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I grew up here. I played football here. I still have my best friends here. You know, it's nice to be able to come. Like, I'm never really here that often anymore, so it's nice to be able to come home. You know, I love this town. My family's still here. And I'm glad I got to be able to share this experience and lucky enough to bring Kevin here and, you know, share, like, my hometown with him. And, you know, it's such a great school and such a great community. So I love being a part of it, and I'm glad we can bring this to you guys.
Thank you.
What are you, loosening up? Is it going to be a tough place?
All right, I got a question for you. How'd it feel to... Kevin, how'd it feel to beat Sean White on the daily?
That was pretty cool to be beating Sean, and you know, it was wild because, yeah, I think I beat him 5 times that year, and it was pretty wild because, like, I was the only one doing it, and it was, like, it was intense to, like, beat the guy that's the best at the sport that you're trying to be the best at. And it was like, that's where I got to, and that's what I'd worked so hard for. And it's like, for so long he was so much better than me, and you know, we'd compete and he'd always win, and then finally to start beating him, that was a really cool feeling.
And how do you guys feel about pushing your own limits?
It's just, that's, it kind of goes with like the goal setting. It's like, you know, what can I do to push myself to get that much better and to try something new. And, you know, it's almost like you're not living if you're just staying in one spot and, you know, you're not pushing yourself, you're not going to get any better. So, you know, I just try and always push myself to do something different or bigger than anyone else can. So.
Yeah, you know, I think that's so important. And that's, you know, so cool about snowboarding is progressing the sport and, you know, taking it to that next level. It's like double corks, and now it's like triple corks, and it's like, how far can you take it? And you know, it's a cool feeling to be able to go up there and do something new that's never been done before. And I think, you know, it's really cool to see where these sports are going because of how the athletes are pushing it. And it's awesome that it's all the athletes that are doing it. You know, it's nobody else. It's not the sponsors. It's not the coaches. It's the athletes that want to take the sport to the next level.
Thank you.
Like, after your guys' injuries, like, how long did it take to, like, gain your confidence back?
Well, for me, it obviously wasn't as serious as Kevin. I mean, that's a completely different category. But it took a little bit. You know, that first time on snow, it's a great feeling, but at the same time, it's terrifying. So I think being able to try it for me was to be able to do a trick and land it, and just knowing that my body was still able to do it. You know, I did everything that I can to get to that point and strengthen my body and just realize that everything still was okay, and now I can proceed and, you know, get back to where I was at.
That was a huge one for me, because, you know, it's, my brain is so fragile now after hitting it. I have, you know, such a higher chance of getting a second brain injury that I just need to be so much more careful. So it's like I can have the confidence, and I do have all the confidence, but, you know, more than confidence, it's being smart. And, you know, it's making sure I go out there and, you know, whatever sport I'm doing, I do it in the right way. And, you know, I do it where I'm not putting myself in too much danger. And that's hard.
Thank you.
Come on, Jackie. Can't believe I'm going to give you a mic.
Uh-oh.
I have to look at my phone because I'll forget the questions.
Got a list.
At any time, did you, like, want to give up and lose your confidence when you, like, couldn't get a trick right? Like, this is for both of you guys. Like, if you kept, like, trying it over, did you, like, lose your confidence and, like, want to give up?
No, I think it's just, it's part of it. You know, you're going to hit those little bumps, but that's the challenge of snowboarding. You know, and it's not, because one day you could be there, you can be landing, you know, 10 double corks one day, and then the next day you can't even do a 180. And just, you know, you got to be able to just, you know, set that aside, and, you know, it's a new day, and come back to it the next day. You know, you can't push it. If it's not there, it's not there.
Yeah, you know, I think that's huge, is you can't fight it. And, you know, there are days, and those days, you know, it might not be working out, and you might not be able to get it, but then, you know, there are those times that it just all kind of clicks and it all starts working, and those are the best days. And that's what's cool about this sport. And, you know, I think that kind of, you know, transfers over, you know, in life. It's like sometimes you have hard days in life, but you can't just give up and throw in the towel. It's like you got to keep fighting. And your phone's blinking like crazy.
Thank you.
All right, guys, we're going to have one more question, okay? One more question, then we have a video, and then we have a couple things for Kevin, all right?
My first question's for Joe.
Yeah.
What was it like to have to decide between staying at Floyd and going to be a snowboarder?
I think that was probably one of the hardest decisions I ever had to make. I thought that I was going to be able to come back my senior year and play football, and the hardest part for me was that growing up here, I played football with the same group of kids since I was 8 years old. And being the quarterback and trying to be the leader for them, and, you know, we were going into that my last year, and I had to call them, and I was like, listen, guys, I'm in a tough predicament right now. I really don't know what to do. I need your advice, and I'm not going to be able to come back my senior year, and I want more than anything to be with you guys, but, you know, I have a decision I have to make, and it's either if I want to play football or if I want to snowboard, and I need your guys' best input. And they were on board with it completely, which made my life that much easier. You know, I felt terrible that, you know, I was leaving them and my family, and that was the hardest part, was I felt like I was letting everyone down here by not staying, but the amount of support that I got from my friends and family made it that much easier for me. So.
And also, even before your injuries, did you ever feel like you just couldn't do it anymore?
There's some days where I'm just like, you know, I'm over like the contest scene, and it's a lot of pressure. But, you know, I love the competition, and, you know, I love just snowboarding. And I think being injured, I would, but not being able to do contests the last few months of the season, I got to be able to just ride, and it was kind of a hectic schedule in the beginning of the year, and I was like, I was really happy just to go out and cruise and, you know, go explore the mountain and just kind of relax and enjoy it, and that kind of brought me back and, you know, made me realize that I do miss the contests and everything like that, but, you know, that's like, that's where it all started, the fun part of it, so.
And the same for you.
Sorry, what was it?
Like, before you got hurt, did you ever feel like you wanted to give up?
No, you know, I never had that feeling of giving up, and I think, you know, that's a huge thing about snowboarding is that, you know, it's all about how much you push yourself and how much you do, because there aren't that many coaches out there, and I never had a coach, so it was always like me pushing myself, and I am the one that got to that level, and it was, you know, it was just that drive. It's like I wanted it so bad, and I loved it so much that, you know, that really helped me, you know, continue. And even on those bad days where you can't do the double cork, you just don't give up, and you just got to keep fighting, and, you know, you just got to know that you will continue to progress.
Thank you.
All right, well, before we wrap things up, we certainly want to make sure that Kevin never forgets Floyd, and I don't think he will. So the first thing, I talked to Joe, and I said, you know, what should we do for Kevin? He said, well, you know, every snowboarder in the world loves stickers. So the first thing you're going to get is a Floyd sticker for your helmet. And you've said this a couple times, the importance of wearing a helmet, a Floyd football helmet.
Because I got one more thing for him.
Uh-oh, is that going to fit?
I'm a huge head.
Yeah, that's probably not going to make it then. Let's see. Oh. Awesome. That's all right. You could put it on the shelf. But this one, I want to make sure that you wear, okay? This is a William Floyd varsity football jersey with your name on the back. Big round of applause for Kevin.
All right, I'm not done yet. I get to return the favor. Hold that for a second. Yeah. All right, so I didn't know I was getting any presents, and I kind of, I think I left this part out of my presentation. Forgot about this one, but you gave me that, what does that sticker say?
Sticker, the Floyd sticker.
The Floyd sticker, so I get to return it with a love sticker. And we started making these too, because like you said, we're in the stickers. I travel with stickers, my love stickers. So, stickers everywhere. Thank you guys so much.